We've studied fire for a long time in Yellowstone. We've documented the incredible recovery of the forests of the 1988 fires. But what's happening now is the baselines are shifting, and basically, if you think about a game, the rules of the game are changing.
So just maybe cross over this meadow and then head into the right again?
Yeah.
I'm an ecologist because I worked in Yellowstone when I was 19 years old as a ranger at Old Faithful. So I saw it before the 1988 Yellowstone fires, and I have studied the fire since that time. There is also a part of me that's a little fearful for what might happen in the future, because the changes that are forecast are so different from what we had initially anticipated, even when we started considering the effects of climate change.
Actually, just to this.
Just to, okay.
If our national parks are changing in ways that are going to profoundly impact the visitor experience, perhaps wildlife habitat, it's important to be able to understand how that may be changing right in front of our eyes.
The fact that forests have regenerated after fire for thousands of years and now they may not be is important and is something that as a society we need to try to understand and then to think about if we're okay with that.
Behind me here, you can see the column of smoke from the North Fork fire. Now that's the fire that's threatening park headquarters. Also, another fire up on the park's borders.
Those fires in 1988 really shepherded in a new era of fire activity in the West. It was after a fairly quiet period of fire activity in western U.S. forests. There was more extensive fire activity than I think most people had ever expected to see in one year at that time.
One of the most important things that when we think about how the forest will change in the future is their ability to recover. And so we call that resilience. And fundamental to that is the ability for a new forest to establish following disturbances. So that's one of the main reasons that we focus so much on the window of time right after the fire, because if you don't get to the forest to establish then, you lose your chance for the forest to grow up.
No cones.
When you think about a place like Yellowstone, the insights that we're learning about how a forest ecosystem comes back after fire, it's not just about going there and seeing the trees and seeing the wildlife. It's also about the forests in Yellowstone or anywhere else where we can apply the insights that we're gaining from Yellowstone have big implications for carbon storage on our planet, for climate regulation on our planet, for water delivery and provisioning to municipalities all throughout the West. Forests are a very key ecosystem that sort of holds together a lot of ecological services that we as a society benefit from, even if you're not living immediately in that area and or visiting that area.
One of the things that really got my attention was the forecast that by the end of this century, the weather conditions that we had in the summer of 1988 would become just the average conditions. And those were the most hottest and driest, the most extreme that we had seen, and those are the kinds of conditions that give you the really big fires. And so as you translate that into what it means for the future of fire in Yellowstone, instead of having fires come back every 100 or 300 years, we would have the weather conditions pretty much all the time that would be associated with big fires. When the fires came through, we were interested in measuring what we call the severity of the fire, but what was the effect on the ecosystem? And we were testing a hypothesis that the severity could be quite high because you have all of the needles of the tree and all of the downed wood very close to each other. We would also be measuring the little baby tree seedlings. It's kind of a hide-and-seek game because you're looking for teeny tiny tree seedlings in a, you know, an area of blackened soil.
Most of the things that we would do for measuring burn severity on the trees are a little bit impossible to do when the trees are so severely burned that they're not here anymore.
The other thing that we're doing with these kinds of data that we're collecting in the field is incorporating them in computer simulation models that look at what the forest of the future might look like.
In my modeling work, what I do is I try to take a tree and represent the way that tree responds to differences in light availability or temperature or moisture What I'm learning from what the model is giving me is essentially how important it is for that initial burst of seedlings after a fire, how important that is in terms of either how sparse or how numerous they are in really setting the trajectory for decades to centuries for what that forest will look like.
With the little green light flashing.
The more field data you have, the better. The more satellite data you have, the better, because that allows you to really constrain the initial conditions to make sure that the point that you're starting from with your simulations is as realistic as possible, that it actually represents what's on the ground. This was the first opportunity to go out in the field and measure some of these really unique combinations of very frequent fire, very large fire. And so that helps us know that we're getting it right with the modeling under current conditions, which then gives us greater confidence about our projections for the future.
This period of regeneration after fire is actually a really critical window where forests are vulnerable to transitioning to really different states than what they were before the fire.
It seems like fire is happening more frequently at a higher severity, burning a larger extent of the landscape. And so if that trajectory continues, what's that going to mean for forests? Is that going to mean that much of the forested landscape in Yellowstone is going to transition to a grassland, or to an aspen parkland, or to a sagebrush steppe environment? Or is the system even more resilient than we even thought it was, and it's going to stay forested at least for another century or more?
When I think about Yellowstone and its potential for change, what I've always been struck by for all of the years I've been studying it is its potential to recover and its potential to be resilient to changes in ways that surprise us. I'm hopeful to see Yellowstone maintain its flora and its fauna and all of the beauty that is there. I'm optimistic that it will still do that, but I don't have any illusion that it will still always be the same. It will change.